to Scotland Yard, the crime took place at 24 Culver Street, Paddington. The murdered woman was a Mrs. Maureen Lyon. In connection with the murder, the police are anxious to interview a man seen in the vicinity, wearing a dark overcoat, light scarf, and a soft felt hat. Motorists are warned against ice-bound roads. The heavy snow is expected to continue, and throughout the country there will be a certain freezing, particularly at points on the north and northeast coast of
Mrs. Barlow.
Birds.
That really does look nice. How stupid of Giles.
Molly? Molly? Molly, where are you?
Doing all the work, you brute.
Oh, there you are. Leave it all to me. Shall I stoke the aga?
Done.
Oh, your hands are cold.
I've just come in.
Why? Where have you been? Surely you've not been out in this weather.
I had to go to the village to get some stuff I'd forgotten. Did you get the chicken netting?
It wasn't the right kind. I went on to another dump, but that wasn't any good either. Practically a whole day wasted. Good Lord, I'm half frozen. The car was skidding like anything. The snow's coming down thick. What do you bet we're not snowed up tomorrow?
I do hope not. If only the pipes don't freeze.
We'll have to keep the central heating well stoked up. Not too good. I do wish they'd send that coke along. We've not got any too much.
I do so want things to go well at first. First impressions are so important.
Is everything ready? Nobody's arrived yet, I suppose.
No, thank goodness. Miss Barlow hooked it early. Afraid of the weather, I suppose.
What a nuisance these daily women are. That leaves everything on your shoulders.
And yours. This is a partnership.
Just as long as you don't ask me to cook.
No, that's my department. And anyway, we've got lots of tins in case we're snowed up. Oh, Giles, do you think it's going to be all right?
Got cold feet, have you? Are you sorry now we didn't sell this place when your aunt left it to you, instead of having the mad idea of running it as a guest house?
No, I love it. And talking of guest house, look at that.
Pretty good, what?
It's a disaster. See, you've left out the S. Monkwell instead of Monkswell.
Good Lord, so I did. However did I come to do that? But it doesn't really matter, does it? Monkwell is as good a name.
You're in disgrace. Go and stoke the central heating.
Across that icy yard? Ugh. Shall I bank it up for the night now?
No, you don't do that till 10 or 11 o'clock at night.
Oh, how appalling.
Hurry, someone may arrive at any minute.
So you've got all the rooms worked out?
Yes. Mrs. Boyle, front four-poster room. Major Metcalf, blue room. Miss Casewell, East Room, and Mr. Wren, Oak Room.
I wonder what all these people will be like. Aren't we to have got rent in advance?
Oh, no, I don't think so.
Ugh, we're rather mugs at this game.
They bring luggage. If they don't pay, we keep their luggage. It's quite simple.
Ugh, for all we know, their suitcases might be just bricks. Wrapped up in newspapers. And where would we be then?
They all wrote from very good addresses.
That's what servants with forged references do. Some of these people may be criminals hiding from the police.
I don't care what they are, so long as they pay us 7 guineas a week.
Oh, you're such a wonderful woman of business, Molly.
And according to Scotland Yard, the crime took place at 24 Culver Street, Paddington. The murdered woman was a Mrs. Maureen Lyon. In connection with the murder, the police are anxious to interview a man seen in the vicinity, wearing a dark overcoat, light scarf, and a soft felt hat. Motorists are warned against ice-bound roads. The heavy snow is expected to continue, and throughout the country there will be a certain freezing.
Gave up at your gate. Wouldn't attempt the drive. No sporting instinct. Are you Mrs. Ralston? How delightful. My name's Wren.
How do you do, Mr. Wren?
You know, Mrs. Ralston, you're not at all as I'd pictured you. I've been thinking of you as a retired general's widow, Indian Army. I thought you'd be terrifically grim and memsahibish in that the whole place would be simply crammed with Bernard's brass. Instead, it's heavenly. Quite heavenly. Lovely proportions. That's a fake. Oh, but this is genuine. Oh. I'm simply going to love it here. Have you got any wax flowers or birds of paradise?
I'm afraid we haven't.
What a pity. What about a sideboard? A purple, plummy, mahogany sideboard with great solid carved fruits on it?
Yes, we have. In the dining room.
In here?
Yes.
I must see it. Absolutely perfect! Real bedrock respectability. But why do away with the center mahogany dining table? Little tables just spoil the effect.
We thought our guests would prefer them. This is my husband.
How do you do? Terrible weather we're having. Takes one back to Dickens and Scrooge and that irritating tiny tip. So bogus. Actually, Mrs. Ralston, you're absolutely right about the little tables. If you had a center mahogany dining table, you would have to have the right family around it. Stern, handsome father with a beard, prolific faded mother, 12 children of assorted ages, a grim governess, and somebody called Poor Harriet, the poor relation who acts as a general dog's body and is very, very grateful for being given a good home. I'll take your suitcase upstairs for you. Oak room, did you say?
Yes.
I do hope it's got a four-poster with little pink roses.
It hasn't.
I don't believe your husband's going to like me. How long have you been married? Are you very much in love?
We've been married for just a year. Would you like to see your room?
Ticked off. But I do so like knowing all about people. I find people so madly interesting, don't you?
I suppose some are and some are not.
No, I don't agree. They're all interesting because you never really know what anyone is like or what they're really thinking. For instance, you do not know what I'm thinking about now, do you?
Not in the least.
There. You see, the only people who know what other people are like are artists, and they don't know why they know it. But if they're portrait painters, it comes out on the canvas.
Are you a painter?
No, I'm an architect. My parents, you see, baptized me Christopher in the hopes that I would become an architect. Christopher and, ha, as good as halfway home. Actually, of course, everybody laughs and makes jokes about St. Paul's.
But, however, I may yet have the last laugh. Chris Wren's prefabness may yet go down in history.
I'm simply going to love this place. I find your wife most sympathetic.
Indeed.
And really, very beautiful.
Oh, don't be absurd.
There. Isn't that like an English woman? Compliments always embarrass them.
European women always take compliments as a matter of course. But English women have all their feminine spirit crushed out of them by their husbands.
There's something very boorish about English husbands.
Come and see your room,
shall I?
Could you stoke the hot water boiler?
Manor, I presume.
Yes.
I am Mrs. Boyle.
I'm Giles Ralston. Come into the fire and warm yourself, Mrs. Boyle. Awful weather, isn't it? Is this your only luggage?
A Major Metcalf, is it? Is seeing to it.
I'll leave the door for him.
The taxi stopped at the gate. It wouldn't risk coming up the drive. We had to share a taxi from the station. There was great difficulty in getting that. Nothing ordered to meet us, it seems.
I am so sorry, Mrs. Boyle. We didn't know what train you would be coming by. Otherwise, of course, we'd have seen that someone was, standing by.
All trains should have been met.
Let me take your coat. My wife will be down in a minute. I'll just go and give Metcalf a hand with the bags.
The drive might at least have been cleared of snow. Most offhand and casual, I must say.
Oh, I'm sorry,
Mrs. Ralston? You're very young.
Young?
To be running an establishment of this kind. You can't have had much experience.
Well, there's got to be a beginning for everything, hasn't there?
Ugh, I see. Quite inexperienced. An old, old house. I hope you haven't got dry rot.
Certainly not.
A lot of people don't know they've got dry rot until it's too late to do anything about it.
The house is in perfect condition.
Could do with a coat of paint. You know, you've got worm in this oak.
This way, Major. This is my wife.
How do you do? Absolute blizzard outside. Thought at one time we shouldn't make it. Oh, I beg your pardon. If it goes on like this, I should say you have 5 or 6 feet of snow by morning. Haven't seen anything like it since I was leaving 1940.
I'll take these bags upstairs. Which rooms did you say? Blue room and the rose room?
No, I gave Mr. Wren the rose room. He liked the four poster so much, so it's Major Metcalf in the blue room and Mrs. Boyle in the oak room.
Major?
Sir?
Do you have much servant difficulty?
We have quite a good local woman who comes in from the village.
And what indoor staff?
No indoor staff, just us.
Oh, indeed. I understood this was a guest house in full running order.
We've only just started.
I would have said that a proper staff of servants was essential before opening an establishment of this kind. Oh, I consider your advertisement most misleading. May I ask if I am the only guest with Major Metcalf?
Oh, no, there are several here.
Oh, and the weather, too. A blizzard, no less. Almost awful.
board. There's another of them. Come in, come in. Afraid my car's bogged down about half a mile. Let me take this. Is there any more luggage in the car?
Oh, no. I've got a light.
Ha!
Glad to see you've got a good fire going.
Mr. Wren, Miss
Casewell.
My wife will be down in a minute.
Oh, no hurry. Gotta get myself thawed out. You know, it looks as though you're going to be snowed in. The weather forecast calls for heavy snows, motorists warned, etc. I do hope you've got plenty of provisions in.
Oh, yes. My wife is an excellent manager. In any case, we can always eat our hens.
Before we start eating each other, hey?
Any news in the paper, apart from the weather?
Oh, usual political crisis. Oh, yes. And a rather juicy murder.
A murder? Oh, I like murder.
They seem to think it was a homicidal maniac. Strangled some woman near Paddington.
Doesn't say much, does it? The police are anxious to interview a man seen in the vicinity of Culver Street at the time. Medium height, wearing a darkish overcoat, a lightish scarf, and a soft felt hat. Police messages to this effect have been broadcast throughout the day.
Well, that's a useful description. Could fit pretty well anyone.
So, when it says that the police are anxious to interview someone, is that a polite way of hinting that he's the murderer?
Could be. Who is the woman who was murdered?
Mrs. Lyon. Mrs. Maureen Lyon.
Young or old?
Doesn't say. Doesn't seem to have been robbery.
This is Miss Casewell, Molly. My wife. How do you do?
Awful night. Would you like to come up and see your room? The water's hot if you'd like a bath.
You're right. I would.
Little Jack Horner sat in a corner. Eating his Christmas pie. He stuck in his thumb and pulled out a plum and said, "What a good boy am I."
I must hurry out to the kitchen and get on with things. Major Metcalf seems like he'll be all right. So Miss Boyle really worries me. We must have a good dinner. I was thinking of opening 2 cans of minced beef and cereals, mashing the potatoes. There's peas and stewed figs and custard. Do you think that'd be all right?
Oh, I should think so. Not very original, perhaps.
Oh, do let me help! I adore cooking.
Why not an omelet? You've got eggs, haven't you?
Yes, we have quite a few fowl. They don't lay as well as they should, but we do put down a lot of eggs.
And if you've got a bottle of cheap, any type wine, you could add it to the minced beef and cereals, did you say? Give it a continental flavor. Well, show me the kitchen and what you've got, and I dare say I shall have an inspiration.
Come on.
Woohoo!
Isn't he sweet? He's put on an apron and says leave everything to him and don't come back for a half an hour. If our guests want to do all the cooking themselves, it will save us a lot of trouble.
Why on earth did you give him the best room?
I told you, he liked the four poster.
He liked the pretty four poster, twerp.
Giles.
I've got no use for that kind. You didn't handle his suitcase. I did.
Had it got bricks in it?
It had no weight at all. If you ask me, there was nothing in it at all. He's probably one of those young men that go about bilking hotel keepers.
No, I don't think so. I like him. This Casewell seems a bit odd, though, don't you think?
Terrible female. She is a female.
Seems quite hard that all our guests should be either difficult or odd. Major Metcalf seems all right, though.
Probably drinks.
Do you think so?
No, I don't. Just feeling a little depressed is all. Well, any case, we know the worst now. They've all arrived.
Who can that be?
Probably the Culver Street murderer.
Don't.
Oh! A thousand pardons. I am... Where am I?
This is Monkswell Manor guest house.
But what stupendous good fortune. Madame. What an answer to prayer. A guest house and a charming hostess. My Rolls Royce, alas, has run into a snowdrift. Blinding snow everywhere. I do not know where I am. Perhaps, I think to myself, I shall freeze to death. Then, I take a little bag, and I stagger through the snow. I see before me big iron gates. A habitation! I am saved! Twice I fall into the snow as I come up your drive. But I arrive, and at last, despair turns to joy. You let me have a room, yes?
Oh, yes.
It's a rather small room, I'm afraid.
Naturally, naturally. You have other guests.
We've only just opened this place as a guest house today, so we're rather new at it.
Charming, charming.
What about your luggage?
That is of no consequence. I have locked the car securely.
But wouldn't it be better to get it in?
No, no. I can assure you, on the night as this, there will be no thieves abroad. As for me, my wants are very simple. I have all I need here in this little bag. Yes, all that I need.
You'd better get thoroughly warm. I'll see about your room. It's a rather cold room, I'm afraid, because it faces north, but all the others are occupied.
You have several guests, then?
Yes, there's Mrs. Boyle and Major Metcalf, Miss Casewell, and a young man called Christopher Wren. And now you.
Yes, the unexpected guest. The guest that you did not invite. The guest who arrived from nowhere, out of the storm. It sounds quite dramatic, does it not? Who am I? You do not know. Where do I come from? You do not know. Me, I am the man of mystery. But now, I tell you this. I complete the picture. From now on, there will be no more arrivals. And no departures either. By tomorrow, even perhaps already, we are cut off from civilization. No butcher, no baker,
No milkman, no postman, no daily papers. Nobody and nothing but ourselves. This is admirable. Quite admirable. My name, by the way, is Perovicini. Mr. and Mrs. Ralston? And this is Monkswell Manor guest house, you said? Good. Perfect. Perfect.
I consider it most dishonest not to have told me they were only just starting this place.
Everything's got to have a beginning, you know. Excellent breakfast this morning. Good coffee, scrambled eggs, homemade marmalade, and all nicely served, too. Little woman does it all herself.
Amateurs. There should be a proper staff.
Excellent lunch, too.
Corned beef.
But well-disguised corned beef. Red wine in it. Mrs. Ralston promised to make us a pie tonight.
Ugh. These radiators are really not hot. I shall speak about it.
Comfortable beds, too. At least, mine was. Hope yours was, too.
It was quite adequate. I don't see why the best bedroom should have been given to that very peculiar young man.
Got here ahead of us. First come, first served.
I got quite a different impression of what this place would be like. A comfortable writing room and a much larger place altogether, with bridge and other amenities.
Regular old Tabby's delight.
I beg your pardon?
I mean, yes. I quite see what you mean.
No, indeed. I shan't stay here long.
No, I don't suppose you will.
Ugh. What an extraordinary young man. Unbalanced mentally in the head, I shouldn't wonder.
Think he's escaped from a lunatic asylum.
I shouldn't be at all surprised.
Giles?
Yes?
Could you shovel the snow away again from the front door?
Coming!
I'll give you a hand, what? Good exercise. Must need exercise.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
Really? What an incredible young woman. Doesn't she know anything about housework? Carrying a carpet sweeper through the front hall? Aren't there any back stairs?
Oh, yes. Nice stairs. Very convenient that there was a fire.
Then why not use them? Anyway, all of the housework should have been done before lunch.
I take it our hostess had to cook the lunch.
Oh, how very amateurish and haphazard. There should be a proper staff.
Not very easy to get nowadays, is it?
No, indeed. The lower classes have no idea of their responsibilities.
Poor old lower class. Got the bit between their teeth, haven't they?
I gather you're a socialist.
Oh, I wouldn't say that. I'm not a red, just pale pink. I'm not interested in politics either. You see, I live abroad.
I suppose conditions are much easier abroad.
Well, I don't have to cook and clean, as I gather most people have to do in this country.
This country has gone sadly downhill. Not what it used to be. I had to sell my house last year. Everything was too difficult.
Hotels and guest houses are easier.
They certainly seem to solve some of one's problems. Are you over in England for long?
Oh, that depends. I have some business to see to. When it's finished, I shall go back.
To France?
No.
Italy?
No.
Ugh.
That woman seems to hunt me down. And then she glares at me. Positively glares.
Would you turn it down a bit?
Is that all right?
Oh, it served its purpose.
What purpose?
Tactics, boy.
Oh, you mean her.
She'd pinched the best chair. I've got it now.
You drove her out. I'm glad. I'm very glad. Let's think of things to do to annoy her, shall we? I wish she'd go away from here.
In this, not a hope.
But when the snow melts.
Oh, when the snow melts, lots of things may have happened.
Yes. Yes, that's true. Snow's rather lovely, isn't it? So peaceful and pure. Makes one forget things.
It doesn't make me forget.
How fierce you sound.
I was thinking.
What sort of thinking?
Ice on a bedroom jug. Chitlins raw and bleeding. One thin, ragged blanket. A child shivering with cold and fear.
My dear, it sounds too grim. What is it? Is it a novel?
You didn't know I was a writer, did you?
Are you?
Sorry to disappoint you. Actually, I'm not.
Yes. Yes, this is Monkswell Manor Guest House. No, Mr. Ralston can't come to the telephone just now. This is Mrs. Ralston speaking. The Berkshire Police? Well, yes. Yes, Superintendent Hogman, but I'm afraid that's impossible. We're snowed up, completely snowed up. The roads are impassable. Well, yes. Hello? Hello?
Molly, do you know where we can find another spade?
Giles, the police have just rung up.
Trouble with the police, eh? Serving liquor without a license?
But he'll never get here.
Well, that's what I told them, but he seemed quite certain that he would.
Nonsense. Even a jeep couldn't get through all this. Anyway, what's it all about?
I don't know. That's what I asked. But he didn't say. Just said that I was to impress upon my husband the importance to listen to whatever Sergeant Trotter, I think it was, had to say, and to follow his orders implicitly. Isn't that extraordinary?
What on earth do you think we've done?
I don't know. Do you think it's those nylons from Gibraltar?
I did remember to get the wireless license, didn't I?
Yes. It's in the kitchen dresser.
I had a rather near shave with the car the other day, but it was entirely the other fellow's fault.
Well, we must have done something.
Probably something to do with running this place. I expect we've ignored some tin pot regulation of some ministry or other. You practically can't avoid it nowadays.
I wish we'd never started this place. We're going to be snowed up. Everyone's cross, and we're going to run out of our reserve of tins.
Oh, cheer up. Everything's all right at the moment. I've brought in the coal scuttles, and I chopped some wood. I've done the aga, and I've done the hens. I'll go chop some kindling next and do the boiler. You know, Molly, it must be something pretty serious to send a police sergeant trekking through all of this. Something rather urgent.
There you are, Mr. Ralston. Did you know that the central heating in the library is practically stone cold?
I'm sorry, Mrs. Boyle. We're a little short of coal.
I am paying 7 guineas a week here. 7 guineas, and I do not want to freeze.
I'll go stoke it up now.
Mrs. Ralston, if you don't mind me saying so, that is a very extraordinary young man you have staying here. His manners and his ties. And does he ever brush his hair?
He's a very brilliant young architect.
I beg your pardon?
Christopher Wren is an architect who...
My dear young woman, naturally I've heard of Sir Christopher Wren. Of course he was an architect. He built St. Paul's. You young people seem to think that no one is educated but yourselves.
I was talking of this Wren. His parents called him Christopher because they hoped he'd be an architect. And he is. Or nearly one, so it turned out all right.
Sounds a fishy story to me. I should make inquiries about him if I were you. What do you know of him?
As much as I know about you, Mrs. Boyle, which is that you are both paying us 7 guineas a week. That's all I need to know, and all that concerns me. I don't care whether I like my guests, or whether I don't.
You are young and inexperienced, and should welcome advice from someone more knowledgeable than yourself. And what about this foreigner?
What about him?
You weren't expecting him, were you?
To turn away a bona fide traveler is against the law, Mrs. Boyle. You should know that.
Why do you say that?
Well, you were a magistrate sitting on the bench, weren't you?
All I'm saying is that this Parafuccini, or whatever he calls himself, seems to me...
Beware, dear lady. You talk of the devil, and there he is.
I didn't see you come in.
I came in on tiptoe, like this. Nobody hears me if I do not want them to.
I find that very amusing.
Indeed.
Now, there was a young lady...
I must get on with my letters. We'll see if it's warmer in the drawing room.
My charming hostess looks upset. What is it, dear lady?
Everything's just rather difficult this morning because of the snow.
Yes, snow makes things difficult, does it not? Or else, it makes them easy. Yes, very easy.
I don't know what you mean.
There is quite a lot you do not know. I think, for one thing, you do not know much about running a guest house.
I dare say we don't, but we mean to make a go of it.
Bravo, bravo.
I'm not such a very bad cook.
You are, without doubt, an enchanting cook. May I give you a word of warning, Mrs. Ralston? You and your husband must not be too trusting, you know. Have you references with these guests of yours?
Is that usual? I always thought people just came.
It is advisable to know a little about the people who sleep under your roof. Take me for an example. I turn up, saying that my car has overturned in a snowdrift. What do you know of me? Nothing at all. I may be a thief, a robber, a fugitive from justice, a madman, even a murderer.
Oh.
You see? And perhaps you know just as little of your other guests.
Well, as far as Mrs. Boyle...
Allow me to poke the fire for you.
Excuse me, Mrs. Wilson. Is your husband about? I'm afraid the pipes of the downstairs cloakroom are frozen.
What an awful day. First the police, and now...
Police?
Police, did you say?
Yes, they telephoned just about a half an hour ago to say they were sending a sergeant out here. I don't think he'll ever get here.
The Rudy Coke's more than half stones, and... Hello, is anything the matter?
I hear the police are on the way here. Why?
Oh, that's all right. No one can get through in all this. Why, the drifts must be 5 feet deep. The roads are all banked up. No one will get here today. Excuse me, Mr. Parabuccini. May I put these down?
Are you Mr. Ralston?
Yes.
Detective Sergeant Trotter, Berkshire Police. Can I get these skis off and stow them somewhere?
Yes. Go around that way to the front door. I'll meet you there.
Thank you, sir.
I suppose that's what we pay our police force for nowadays, to go about enjoying themselves at winter sports.
Mrs. Ralston, why did you send for the police?
But I didn't.
Who's that man? Where'd they come from? He passed by the drawing room window on skis. All over snow and looking terribly hardy.
You may believe it or not, but that man is a policeman. A policeman skiing.
This is Detective Sergeant Trotter.
Good afternoon.
You're not a sergeant. You're too young.
I'm not quite as young as I look, madam.
But terribly athletic. We'll stow your skis away under the stairs.
Thank you, sir.
Excuse me, Mrs. Ralston. May I use your telephone?
Of course, Major Metcalf.
I always think that very attractive, don't you think so?
No brains. You can see that at a glance.
Hello? Hello? Mrs. Ralston, this phone is dead. Quite dead.
It was all right about a half an hour ago.
Line's gone with the way of the snow, I suppose.
So we're quite cut off now. Quite cut off. That's funny, isn't it?
I don't see anything to laugh at.
No, indeed.
Ah, it's a private joke of my own. Hist, the sleuth is returning.
Now we can get to business, Mr. Ralston. Mrs. Ralston.
Do you want to see us alone? If so, we can go into the library.
It won't be necessary, sir. It'll save time if everybody's present. If I might sit at this table.
I beg your pardon.
Thank you.
Oh, do hurry up and tell us. What have we done?
Done? Oh, it's nothing of that kind, Mrs. Ralston. It's something quite different. It's more a matter of police protection, if you understand me.
Police protection?
Yes. It relates to the death of Mrs. Lyon. Mrs. Maureen Lyon, of 24 Culver Street, London, West 2, who was murdered yesterday, the 15th instant. You may have heard or read about the case?
Yes, I heard it on the wireless. The woman who was strangled?
That's right, madam. Now, the first thing I want to know is if you were acquainted with this Mrs. Lyon.
Never heard of her.
You may have known her under the name of Lyon. Lyon wasn't her real name. She had police record, and her fingerprints were on file, so we were able to identify her without any difficulty. Her real name was Maureen Stanning. She had a husband, John Stanning, who resided at Longbridge Farm, not very far from here.
Longbridge Farm? Wasn't that where those children?
Yes. The Longbridge Farm case.
Three children.
That's right, miss. The Corrigans. Two boys and a girl. Brought before the court as in need of care and protection. A home was found for them with Mr. and Mrs. Stanning at Longbridge Farm. One of the children subsequently died as the result of criminal neglect and persistent ill treatment. The case made a bit of a sensation at the time.
It was horrible.
The Stannings were sentenced to terms of imprisonment. Stanning died in prison. Mrs. Stanning served her sentence and was duly released. Yesterday, as I said, she was found strangled at 24 Culver Street.
Who did it?
I'm coming to that, madam. A notebook was picked up near the scene of the crime. In that notebook was written two addresses. One was 24 Culver Street. The other was Monkswell Manor.
What?
That's right, sir. That's why Superintendent Hogben, on receiving this information from Scotland Yard, thought it imperative for me to come out here and find out if there was any connection between this house or anyone in this house and the Longbridge Farm case.
A connection? There's nothing. Absolutely nothing. It must be a coincidence.
Superintendent Hogben doesn't think it is a coincidence, sir. He'd have come himself if it had been in any way possible. Under the weather conditions, and as I can ski, he sent me with the instructions to get full particulars of everyone in the house, to report back to him by phone, and to take whatever measures I thought fit to ensure the safety of the household.
Safety? Good Lord, he's not suggesting that someone is going to be killed here.
I don't want to frighten any of the ladies, but frankly, yes, that is the idea.
But why?
That's what I'm here to find out.
That's crazy.
Yes, sir. It's because it's crazy that it's dangerous.
I must say, it seems a bit far-fetched.
I think it's wonderful.
Is there something you haven't told us, Sergeant Trotter?
Yes, madam. Underneath the two addresses was written, "This is the first." And on the dead woman's body was a piece of paper with the words, "Three blind mice." And below those words, a drawing of three blind mice and a bar of music. The music was the tune of Three Blind Mice. You know how it goes.
Three blind mice, see how they run. They all ran after the farmer's wife. That's horrible.
There were three children and one died?
Yes, the youngest, boy of 11.
What happened to the other two?
The girl was adopted by someone. We haven't been able to trace her present whereabouts. The boy would now be about 22, deserted from the army, and has not been heard of since. According to army psychologists, was definitely schizophrenic. That's to say, a bit queer in the head.
But you think that it was he who killed that woman in London? And now he's going to come here to kill one of us? Why?
That's what I've got to find out from you. As Superintendent Hogman sees it, there must be some connection. Now you state, sir, that you yourself have never had any connection with the business at Longridge Farm?
No.
And the same goes for you, madam?
No connection.
What about servants?
We haven't got any servants. That reminds me. It'll be all right, Sergeant Trotter, if I went to the kitchen. I'll be there if you need me.
That's certainly all right, Mrs. Ralston. Now, can I have all your names, please?
This is ridiculous. We were merely staying at a kind of hotel. We only arrived yesterday, and we aren't planning on staying.
You'd planned to come here in advance, though. You'd booked your rooms here ahead.
Well, yes. All except Mr.
Peravocini. My car overturned in a snowdrift.
I see.
What I'm getting at is that anyone who's been following you around lately might have known very well that you were coming here. Now, there's just one thing I want to know, and I want to know it quick. Which one of you is it that has some connection with the business at Longridge Farm? You're not being very sensible, you know. One of you is in danger, deadly danger. I've got to know which one that is. All right, fine. I'll ask you one by one. You first.
Since you seem to have arrived here more or less by accident, Mr. Paparazzi.
Peravocini. But my dear inspector, I know nothing, but nothing of what you have been talking about. I am a stranger in this country. And I know nothing of these local affairs of bygone years.
Mrs.
Boyle. Really, I consider this an impertinence. Why on earth should I have anything to do with such distressing business?
You tell me. Miss
Casewell. Leslie Casewell. I never heard of Longridge Farm, and I know nothing about it.
You, sir?
Metcalf, Major. Read about the case in the papers at the time. Was stationed in Edinburgh then. No personal knowledge.
And you?
Christopher Wren. I was a mere child at the time, and I don't even remember hearing about it.
And that's all you have to say?
All right. Well, if one of you gets murdered, you'll have yourselves to blame. Now then, Mr. Ralston, can I have a look around the house?
My dears, how melodramatic. I do admire the police. So stern and hard-boiled. Quite a thrill, this whole business. Three blind mice. How does the tune go?
Really, Mr. Wren?
Why, don't you like it? But it's a signature tune. The signature of the murderer. Just fancy what a kick he must be getting out of it.
Melodramatic rubbish. I don't believe a word of it.
Oh, just you wait, Mrs. Boyle. Until I creep up behind you and you feel my hands on your throat.
That'll do, Christopher. It's a poor joke. In fact, it's not a joke at all.
Oh, but it is. That's exactly what it is. A madman's joke. Just fancy. That's what just makes it so deliciously macabre. My dears. Oh, if you could just see your faces.
He is such an ill-mannered and neurotic young man.
Where's Giles?
Taking our policeman on a conducted tour of the house.
Your friend the architect has been behaving in a most abnormal manner.
Young fellow seems nervy nowadays. Dare say, he'll grow out of it.
Nerves. I have no patience with people who say they have nerves. I have no nerves.
Oh, really?
No. Perhaps that's just as well for you, Mrs. Boyle.
Why do you say that?
I think you were one of the magistrates on the bench at the time.
Ugh.
In fact, you were responsible for sending those three children to Longridge Farm.
Really, Major Metcalf? I can hardly be held responsible. We had reports from welfare workers, and the farm people seemed very nice and most anxious to have the children. It was almost satisfactory. Eggs and fresh milk and a healthy out-of-doors life.
Kicks, blows, starvation, and a thoroughly vicious couple.
How was I supposed to know? They were very civilly spoken.
Yes. I was right. It was you.
One tries to do a public duty, and all one gets is abuse.
You must forgive me. But I find all this very amusing. I enjoyed myself greatly.
Where did he come from last night?
I don't know.
Looks a bit of a spiv to me. Makes his face up, too. Rouge and powder. Disgusting. He must be quite old.
And yet he moves about as though he were quite young.
Yes.
You'll be wanting more wood. I'll get it.
It's only 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and yet it's already so dark. I'll turn on the lights.
Now, where did I leave my pen?
That's better. What a horrid little tune that is.
Don't you like it? Reminds you of your childhood, perhaps? An unhappy childhood?
I was very happy as a child.
You were lucky.
Weren't you happy?
No.
I'm sorry.
But all that's a long time ago. One gets over things.
I suppose.
Or does one? Rather hard to say.
They say that what happens when you're a child matters more than anything else.
They say? They say? Who says?
Psychologists.
Oh, humbug. Just a lot of nonsense. I've no use for psychologists and psychiatrists.
I've never really had much to do with them myself.
It's a good thing for you haven't. It's all out of hooey, the whole thing. Life's what you make it. Go straight ahead and don't look back.
One can't always help looking back.
Nonsense. It's a question of willpower.
I expect you're right, but sometimes things happen to make you remember.
Don't give in. Turn your back on them.
Do you suppose that's really the way? But maybe that's all wrong. Maybe one really ought to face them.
Depends what you're talking about.
Sometimes I hardly know what I'm talking about.
Nothing from the past is going to affect me, except in the way I want it to.
Well, everything's all right upstairs. What's in here? Drawing room?
Would you mind shutting that door? This place is full of trash.
Sorry, madam, but I've got to get the lay of the land. Well, that completes the tour. Nothing suspicious. I think I'll make my report now to Superintendent Hogben.
Oh, but you can't. The line's down.
What? Since when?
Major Metcalf tried it about a half an hour ago.
But it was all right earlier. Superintendent Hogben got through all right.
Yes, I suppose since then it's gone with the snow.
I wonder. It may have been cut.
Cut? But who could cut it?
Mr. Ralston, just how much do you know about these people who are staying in your guest house?
We don't really know very much about them. Mrs. Boyle wrote from a hotel in Bournemouth. Major Metcalf from an address in, where was it?
Leamington.
Christopher Wren wrote from Hampstead, and the Casewell women from a private hotel in Kensington. Paravicini, as we told you before, turned up out of the blue last night. Still, I suppose they've got ration books and that sort of thing.
I shall go into all that, of course, but there is not much reliance to be placed on that sort of evidence.
But even if the killer is trying to get here, we're quite safe now because of the snow.
Unless he's here already.
Here already?
Think about it, Mr. Ralston. All these people arrived here yesterday evening, some hours after the murder of Mrs. Stanning. Plenty of time to get here.
But except for Paravicini, they'd all booked beforehand.
Well, why not? These crimes were planned.
Crimes? There's only been one crime in Culver Street. Why are you so sure there'll be another one here?
That it'll happen here? No. I hope to prevent that. That it will be attempted? Yes.
I just don't believe it. It's so fantastic.
It isn't fantastic. It's just facts.
You have a description of what this man looked like in London?
Medium height, indeterminate build, darkish overcoat, soft felt hat, face hidden by muffler. The killer spoke in a whisper. There are three darkish overcoats hanging up in the hall now, Mr. Ralston. One of them is yours. There are three lightish felt hats.
I don't believe it.
See, it's this telephone wire that worries me. If it's been cut...
I must go and do the vegetables.
Do you have an extension?
I beg your pardon. Did you say something?
Yes, Miss Ralston. I said, do you have an extension?
Yes. Up in our bedroom.
Go and try it up there for me, will you? Who's left the window open?
Come to understand what I may term as the mechanics of fear. You have to study the precise effect produced on the human mind. Imagine, for instance, that you are alone in a room. It is late in the afternoon. A door opens softly behind you.
Think, Mrs. Ralston. Try and think.
I can't think. My head's numbed.
Mrs. Boyle had only just been killed when you got to her. Are you sure you didn't see or hear anybody as you came along the hallway?
I don't know. All I could hear was the radio blaring out in here. I couldn't think who turned it on so loud.
That was clearly the murderer's idea that you couldn't hear anything.
How could I hear anything else?
You might have done. If the murderer had left the hall going that way, he might have heard you coming from the kitchen. He might have slipped up the back stairs or into the dining room.
I think, I'm not sure, but I think I heard a door creak and shut just after I left the kitchen.
Which door?
I don't know.
Please, Mrs. Ralston, try and think. Upstairs, downstairs, close at hand, right, left?
I don't know. I'm not even sure I heard anything.
Can't you leave her alone? Can't you see she's all in?
We're investigating a murder, Mr. Ralston. Up to now, nobody has taken this thing seriously. Mrs. Boyle didn't. She held out on me with information. Well, she's dead. Unless we get to the bottom of this, and quickly mind, there may be another death.
Another? Nonsense. Why?
Because at 24 Culver Street, there is only one possible victim. Well, she's dead. But here at Monkswell Manor, there is a much wider field.
Nonsense. Surely it would be a most unlikely coincidence. There should be two such people brought here completely by chance. Both with a connection in the Longridge Farm case?
Given certain circumstances, it wouldn't be so much of a coincidence. Think it out, Miss Casewell. Now, I want to get down quite clearly where everybody was when Mrs. Boyle was killed. I've already got Mrs. Ralston's statement. You were in the kitchen preparing vegetables. You walked out of the kitchen, went along the hallway, through the swing doors,
and in here. The radio was blaring, but the hall was dark, and the lights were turned off. You turned the lights on, saw Mrs. Boyle, and screamed.
Yes. I screamed and screamed. Finally, people came.
Yes. As you say, people came. A lot of people. All coming from different directions, more or less at once. Now then, when I got out of that window to try the extension wire, you, Mr. Ralston, went upstairs to the bedroom you and Mrs. Ralston occupy to try the extension telephone there. Where were you when Mrs. Ralston screamed?
I was up in the bedroom. The extension was down, too. I opened the window to see if I could see where it had been cut, but I didn't see anything. Just as I was closing the window, I heard Molly scream, and I ran down.
Those simple actions took you rather a long time, didn't they?
I don't think so.
Yes, I should say you definitely took your time over them.
I was thinking about something.
Very well.
Now then, Mr. Wren, I'll have your account of where you were.
I'd been in the kitchen, seeing if there was anything I could do to help Mrs. Ralston. After all, I adore cooking. After that, I went upstairs to my bedroom.
Why?
It's quite a natural thing to go to one's bedroom, don't you think? I mean, one does want to be alone sometimes.
You went to your bedroom because you wanted to be alone.
And I wanted to brush my hair and, tidy up.
You wanted to brush your hair.
Anyway, that's where I was.
And you came down.
Yes.
Curious that you and Mr. Ralston didn't meet on the stairs.
I came down by the back stairs. They're nearer to my room.
Did you go to your room by the back stairs, or did you come through here?
I went up by the back stairs, too.
I see. Mrs. Ralston in the kitchen. Mr. Ralston in his bedroom. Mr. Wren ditto. Parvicini.
I have told you. I was playing the piano in the drawing room. Through there, Inspector.
I'm not an inspector, just a sergeant, Parvicini. Did anybody hear you playing the piano?
I do not expect so. I was playing very, very softly with one finger. So.
You were playing Three Blind Mice.
Is that so?
Yes, but it is such a catchy little tune. How shall I say? A haunting tune. Don't you all agree?
I think it's horrible.
And yet, it runs in people's heads. Someone was whistling it, too.
Whistling it? Where?
Oh, I'm not sure. Perhaps in the front hall? Or on the stairs? Maybe upstairs in one of the bedrooms.
Who was whistling Three Blind Mice? Are you making this up, Parvicini?
No, no, Inspector. I beg your pardon, Sergeant. I would never do a thing like that.
Well, go on. You're playing the piano.
With one finger. Suddenly, I hear the radio playing very loudly. Someone is shouting on it. It offended my ears. Then, after that, I hear Mrs. Ralston scream.
Miss Casewell?
I was writing letters in the library.
Could you hear what was going on in here?
No, not until Mrs. Ralston started screaming.
And you came down?
Yes.
At once?
I think so.
You say you were writing letters when you heard Mrs. Ralston scream?
Yes.
And got up from the writing desk in the library hurriedly and came in here?
Yes.
And yet, there doesn't seem to be any unfinished letter on the writing desk in the library.
I brought it with me.
Dearest Jessie. Friend of yours?
Or a relation?
That's none of your danged business.
Perhaps not. You know, if I were to hear someone screaming blue murder when I was writing a letter, I don't think I'd take the time to pick up my unfinished letter, fold it, and place it in my handbag before going to see what was the matter.
You wouldn't. How interesting.
Now then, Major Metcalf, you say you were in the cellar. Why?
Looking around. I looked into that cupboard place under the stairs near the kitchen. Lots of junk and sports tackle. I opened a door and noticed a flight of steps. I was curious and went on down. Interesting cellars you've got there.
Glad you liked them.
Not at all. Crypt of an old monastery, I should say. Probably why this place is called Monkswell.
We're not engaged in antiquarian research, Major Metcalf. We're investigating a murder. Mrs. Ralston said that she heard a door shut with a faint creak. Now, that particular door shuts with a creak. It may be, you know, that the murderer, after hearing Mrs. Ralston coming from the kitchen, right after he killed Mrs. Boyle, decided to slip into the cupboard, pulling the door to after him.
A lot of things could be.
There would be fingerprints on the inside of the cupboard.
Mine are there, all right. But most criminals are careful to wear gloves, are they not?
It's usual, but all criminals slip up sooner or later.
Now, I wonder if that is really true.
Look here, Sergeant. Aren't we wasting time? There's only one
person. Mr. Ralston, I'm in charge of this investigation.
Well, very well, but
Mr. Ralston! Thank you.
We've got to establish opportunity, you know, as well as motive. Now, let me tell you this. You all had opportunity. There are two staircases. Anyone could go up by one and come down by the other. Anyone could go down to the cellars by the door near the kitchen and come up again through the flight of stairs that leads up through a trap door to the foot of the stairs over there. The vital fact is that every one of you was alone at the time the murder was committed.
You speak as though we are all under suspicion. That's absurd.
In a murder case, everyone is under suspicion.
But you know pretty well who killed that woman in Culver Street. It was the eldest of those three children, a mentally abnormal young man who is now about the age of 23. There is only one person here who fits that description.
It's not true! You're all against me! Everyone's always been against me! You're gonna frame me for a murder! It's persecution, I tell you, persecution!
Steady, lad, steady.
Nobody's against you, Christopher. Tell him it's not true.
We don't frame people.
Tell him you're not going to arrest him.
I'm not going to arrest anyone. To do that, I've got to have evidence. I haven't got any evidence. Yet.
Molly, you're crazy. And so are you. There's only one person who fits the description. And if only as a safety measure, he ought to be put under arrest. It is only fair to the rest of us.
Wait, Giles. Sergeant Trotter, could I talk to you for a moment?
Certainly, Mrs. Ralston. Will the rest of you go into the dining room, please?
But, Sergeant, I thought...
You too, Giles.
I'm staying.
Giles, please.
Molly, I don't know what's come over you. I'm staying.
Giles, I mean it.
Yes, Mrs. Ralston? What is it you want to say to me?
Sergeant Trotter, you think it was the eldest of those three children who killed that woman in London. But you don't know that, do you?
We don't know a thing. All we've got so far is that the woman who joined with her husband in ill-treating and starving those children has been killed, and that the woman magistrate responsible for placing them there has been killed. The telephone wire that links me with police headquarters has been cut.
But you don't even know that. It may have just been the snow.
No, Mrs. Ralston. The line was deliberately cut. It was cut just outside by the front door. I found the place.
I see.
Sit down, Mrs. Ralston.
But all the same, you don't know.
I'm going by probability. At all points, just one way. Mental instability, childish mentality, desertion from the army, and the psychiatrist's report.
I know. And therefore, all seems to point to Christopher. But I don't believe that it is Christopher. There must be other possibilities.
Such as?
Well, hadn't those children any relations at all?
The mother was a drunk. She died soon after the children were taken away from her.
What about the father?
The father was an army sergeant serving abroad. If he's alive, he's probably been discharged from the army by now.
You don't know where he is now?
No. To acquire that information may take some time. But I can assure you, Mrs. Ralston, we police take every eventuality into account.
But you don't know where he may be at this very moment. And if the son is mentally unstable, the father may be as well.
Yes, that's a possibility.
If he'd been a prisoner with the Japs, perhaps, and having suffered terribly, and came home and found his wife dead, and that his children had gone through some terrible experience, and that one of them had died through it, he might go off his head a little and want revenge.
Why, that's only surmise.
But it's possible.
Oh yes, Mrs. Ralston, it's quite possible.
So then the killer may be middle-aged, or even old. When I said the police had rung up, Major Metcalf looked awfully upset. He really did. I saw his face.
Major Metcalf?
He's middle-aged, a soldier, and I know he seems quite nice and normal, but it mightn't show, mightn't it?
No. Often it doesn't show at all.
So then, it's not just Christopher who's a suspect. There's Major Metcalf as well.
Any other suggestions?
Paravicini did drop the poker when I said the police had rung up.
Paravicini?
I know he seems quite old and foreign and everything, but he mightn't be as old as he looks. He moves like a much younger man, and he's definitely got makeup on his face. Miss Casewell noticed it too.
I know it sounds quite melodramatic, but he might be in disguise.
You're very anxious, aren't you, that it shouldn't be young Mr. Wren?
He seems so helpless somehow, and so unhappy.
Let me tell you something, Mrs. Ralston. I've had all possibilities in mind ever since the beginning. The boy Georgie, the father, and someone else. There was a sister, you remember?
The sister?
Yes. It may have been a woman who killed Maureen Lyon. A woman. The muffler pulled up, and the man's felt hat pulled well down, and the killer whispered, you know? It's the voice that gives the sex away. Yes, it may have been a woman.
Miss Casewell.
She looks a bit old for the part. Oh yes, Mrs. Ralston. There's quite a wide field. There's yourself, for instance.
Me?
Yes, you're about the right age.
No,
whatever you tell me about yourself, I've got no means of checking it at this moment. And then, there's your husband.
Giles, don't be ridiculous.
He and Christopher Wren are much of an age. Say, your husband looks older than his years, and Christopher Wren looks younger. Actual age is very hard to tell. How long had you known Giles Ralston?
What do you mean? Since when?
Before you married him. How long have you even been married?
Well, just a year.
And you met him? Where?
At a dance in London. We went in a party.
Did you meet his people?
He hasn't got any people. They're all dead.
They're all dead?
You make it sound all wrong. His father was a barrister and his mother died when he was a baby.
You're only telling me what he told you.
Yes, but...
You don't know it of your own knowledge?
No.
Mrs. Ralston, you'd be surprised at how many cases rather like yours we get, especially since the war. Homes broken up, families killed. Fellow says he's been in the Air Force or just finished his Army training. Parents killed. No relations. There aren't any backgrounds nowadays, and young people settle their own affairs. They meet and marry. It's parents and relatives who used to make the inquiries before consenting to an engagement. That's all done away with. Girl just marries her man. Sometimes she doesn't find out for a year or more that he's an absconding bank clerk or an army deserter. Or something equally undesirable. Just how long had you known Giles Ralston when you married him?
Just 3 weeks, but...
And you don't know anything about him?
That's not true. I know everything about him. I know exactly the kind of person he is. He's Giles. It's absolutely absurd to suggest that he's some crazy homicidal maniac. He wasn't even in London yesterday when the murder took place.
Really? Where was he? Here.
He went off in the car to the country to sail a netting for our chickens.
Bring it back with him?
It turned out to be the wrong kind.
Only 30 miles from London, aren't you? Oh, you got an ABC. Only an hour by train, a little longer by car.
I tell you, Giles was not in London.
Mrs. Ralston, let me show you something. This your husband's coat?
Yes.
Evening News.
Yesterday's.
Sold on the streets about 3:30 yesterday afternoon.
I don't believe it.
Don't you?
Don't you?
Molly!
You startled me.
Where is he? Where is he gone?
Who?
The sergeant!
He went out that way.
If only I could get away. Somehow. Some way. Is there anywhere I could hide? In the house?
Hide?
Yes, from him!
Why?
But, darling, they're all so frightfully against me. They're going to say I've committed these murders, particularly your husband.
Never mind him. You can't go running away from things all your life, Christopher.
Why do you say that?
Well, it's true, isn't it?
Oh, yes. It's quite true.
Your name's not really Christopher Wren, is it?
No.
And you're not really training to be an architect?
No.
Why did you
call myself Christopher Wren? It just amused me. And then they used to laugh at me at school and call me Little Christopher Robin. Robin, Wren, association of ideas. It was so hard being at school.
What's your real name?
We needn't go into that. I ran away whilst I was doing my army service. It was all so beastly, I hated it. Yes, I'm just like the unknown murderer. I told you I was the one the specification fitted. You see, my mother...
Yes, your mother.
Everything would be all right if she hadn't died. She would have looked after me and taken care of me and... Oh.
You can't go on being taken care of all your life. Things happen to you, and you've got to bear them. You've got to go on just as usual.
One can't do that.
Yes, one can.
You mean you have?
Yes.
What was it? Something very bad.
Something I've never forgotten.
Was it to do with Giles?
No, it was long before I met Giles.
You must have been very young. Almost a child.
Perhaps that's why it was so awful. It was horrible. I try to put it out of my mind. I try never to think about it.
So you're running away too. Running away from things, instead of facing them.
Yes, I suppose in a way I am. You know, considering we hadn't seen each other until just yesterday, we seemed to understand each other rather well.
Yes, it's quite true.
Suppose there's rather a sympathy between us.
Anyway, you think I ought to stick it out?
Well, quite frankly, what else can you do?
I could pinch the sergeant's skis. I could ski quite well.
That would be frightfully stupid. It'd be almost like admitting you're guilty.
Sergeant Trotter thinks I'm guilty.
No, he doesn't. Or else, I don't know what he thinks. And he can put ideas into your head. Things that aren't true. That can't possibly be true.
Who?
Sergeant Trotter.
What is all this?
I hate him. I hate him. I hate him. I don't believe it. I won't believe it.
Won't believe what? Come on, out with it!
See that?
Yes.
What is it? It's a London paper. Yesterday's. It was in Giles' overcoat pocket. But Giles didn't go to London yesterday. Well, if he was here all day.
But he wasn't. He went off looking for netting for our chickens. But it turned out to be the wrong kind.
Well, that's all right. Perhaps he did go up to London after all.
But why shouldn't he tell me that he did? Why pretend that he'd been racing about the countryside?
Perhaps with the news of the murder.
But he didn't know about the murder. Or did he?
Good Lord, Molly. You don't think... Sergeant Trotter doesn't think that you're...
I don't know what he thinks. But he can make you think things about people. You ask yourself questions and you begin to doubt. You think that somebody you love and know well might be a stranger. That's what happens in a nightmare. You're surrounded by friends, and then you look at their faces, and they're not your friends anymore. They're just people pretending. Perhaps you can't trust anyone. Perhaps everyone's a stranger.
I seem to be interrupting something.
We were just talking. I have to go to the kitchen. There's the vegetables and I have to do the spinach.
I'll come give you a hand.
No, you won't.
Childs.
Tete-tetes aren't very healthy things at present. You keep out of the kitchen and keep away from my wife.
Now look here.
You keep away from my wife, Ren. She's not going to be the next victim.
So that's what you think of me.
I've already said so, haven't I? There's a killer loose in this house, and it seems to me you fit the bill.
I'm not the only one to fit the bill.
I don't see who else does.
How blind are you? Or do you just pretend to be blind?
I tell you, I'm looking after my wife's safety.
Well, so am I. I'm not going to leave you here alone with her.
What the heck are you,
Giles?
Please go, Christopher.
I won't go.
Christopher, I mean it.
I shan't be far away.
What is all this, Molly? You must be crazy. Perfectly prepared to shut yourself up in the kitchen with a homicidal maniac?
He isn't.
You only have to look at him to see that he's Barney.
He isn't, Giles. I tell you, he's not dangerous. I'd know if he was. And anyway, I can take care of myself.
That's what Mrs. Boyle said.
Giles, don't.
Look here. What is there between you and that wretched boy?
Between us? I'm sorry for him, that's all.
Perhaps you've met him before. Perhaps you suggested that he come down here and you both pretend to meet for the first time. All cooked up between you, was it?
Giles, don't be absurd.
Rather odd, isn't it, that he should come and stay in an out-of-the-way place like this?
No more strange than that Mrs. Boyle or Miss Casewell or Major Metcalf should.
I read once in a paper that these homicidal cases were able to attract women. Looks as though it were true. Where did you first know him? How long has this been going on?
You know perfectly well that I didn't set eyes on Christopher until he arrived here yesterday.
That's what you say. Perhaps you've been running up to London to meet him on the sly.
How dare you suggest these things? I have not been up to London for weeks.
You haven't been up to London for weeks. Is that so?
What do you mean? It's quite true.
Is it? Then what's this? This is the glove you were wearing yesterday. You dropped it, and I picked it up this afternoon when I was talking to Sergeant Trotter. You see what's inside it? A London bus ticket.
All right, so...
So it seems you not only went to the village yesterday, but you went to London as well.
All right.
Whilst I was safely away, racing about the countryside.
Whilst you were safely away, racing about the countryside?
Come on, admit it. You went to London.
All right. I went to London. So did you.
What?
So did you. You brought back an evening paper.
Where did you get a hold of this?
It's in your overcoat pocket.
Anyone could have put it there.
Did they? No. You went to London.
All right, yes. I went to London. But I didn't go to meet a woman there.
Didn't you? Are you sure you didn't?
Eh? What do you mean?
Don't come near me.
What's the matter?
Don't come near me. Don't touch me.
Did you go to London yesterday to meet Christopher Wren?
Don't be a fool, Giles. Of course I didn't.
Then why did you go?
I shan't tell you that. Perhaps now I've forgotten why I went.
Molly, what's come over you? I feel as if I don't know you anymore.
Perhaps you never did know me. We've been married how long? A year? But you don't really know anything about me. What I'd thought or done or suffered before you knew me.
Molly, you're crazy.
All right, I'm crazy. Perhaps it's fun to be crazy.
What the heck are you?
No. I do hope you two young people aren't saying a little more than you mean. One is so apt to in these lovers' quarrels.
Lovers' quarrels. That's good.
Quite so. I know just how you feel. I've been through all this myself. When I was a younger man. Jeunesse, as the poet says. Not been married long, I imagine.
That is no business of yours, Paravicini.
No. No business at all. But I just came in to say that the sergeant cannot find his skis. And I'm afraid he's very annoyed.
Christopher.
What?
Nothing.
He wants to know if you have, by any chance, removed them, Mr. Austin?
No, of course not.
Mr. Ralston. Mrs. Ralston, have you removed a pair of skis from the cupboard near the kitchen door?
Certainly not.
Somebody's taken them.
I wonder what made you happen to look for them.
The snow is still lying. I need help here. Reinforcements. I was going to ski over to the police station in Market Hampton to report on the situation.
And now you can't. Dear. Someone has seen to it that you certainly shan't do that. But there could be another reason.
Yes, what?
Somebody may want to get away.
What did you mean when you said Christopher just now?
Nothing.
So, our young architect has hooked it, has he? Very, very interesting.
Is this true, Mrs. Ralston?
Oh, he didn't go after all.
Did you take my skis, Mr. Wren?
Your skis, Sergeant? No. Why should I?
Mrs. Ralston seemed to think.
Christopher Wren is very fond of skiing. Thought he might have taken them to get a little exercise.
Exercise? Now listen, you people. This is a serious matter. Somebody has removed my only chance of communication with the outside world. I want everybody in here again, at once.
I think Miss Casewell has gone upstairs.
I'll get her.
I left Major Metcalf in the dining room. Major Metcalf! He's not there now.
I'll go find him.
Sit down, Mrs. Ralston. Miss Casewell.
Hello. Wanting me?
It's the question of my skis.
Skis? Mr. Ralston!
Yes. Somebody's removed a pair of skis from the cupboard near the kitchen door. Do either of you two know where they went?
Good Lord, no. Why should I?
And I haven't touched them.
Nevertheless, they are gone. Which way did you go to your room just now?
By the back stairs.
Then you passed the cupboard door.
If you say so. I've no idea where our skis are.
You were actually in that cupboard today.
Yes, I was.
At the time Mrs. Boyle was killed.
At the time Mrs. Boyle was killed, I'd gone down to the cellar.
Were the skis in the cupboard when you passed through?
Haven't the least idea.
Didn't you see them there?
Can't remember.
You must remember if the skis were there then.
No good shouting at me, young fellow. I wasn't thinking of any dang skis. I was interested in the cellars. Architecture of this place is very interesting. I opened the other door and went on down. So I can't tell you if the skis were there or not.
You realize that you yourself had an excellent opportunity of taking them?
Yes, yes. I'll grant you that. If I had wanted to, that is.
The question is, where are they now?
Ought to be able to find them. Not a case of hunt the thimble. Whacking great things, skis. Suppose we all set to.
Not quite so fast, Major Metcalf. That may be, you know, what we're meant to do.
I don't get you.
I'm in the position now where I've got to put myself in the place of a crazy, cunning brain. I've got to ask myself what he wants us to do and what he himself is planning to do next. I've got to keep just one step ahead of him, because if I don't, there's going to be another death.
You still don't believe that?
Yes, Miss Casewell, I do. Three blind mice. Two mice canceled out. One little mouse still left to be dealt with. There are six of you here listening to me. One of you is a killer. I don't know which yet, but I shall. And another of you is the killer's prospective victim. That's the person I'm speaking to. Mrs. Boyle held out on me with information. You all held out on me with information. Well, she's dead. Unless we get to the bottom of this, and you tell me exactly what is going on, you too will be killed. Anybody who's killed twice isn't even going to hesitate to kill a third time. And as it is, I don't know which of you it is who needs protection. Come on now. Anybody here who has anything, however slight, to reproach themselves for in that bygone business had better come out with it. All right. You won't. I'll get the killer. I've no doubt of that. But it may be too late for one of you. And I'll tell you another thing. The killer's enjoying this. Yes, he's enjoying himself a good deal. All right, you can go.
Talking of chicken, dear lady, have you ever tried chicken livers served on toast that has been thickly smeared with foie gras with a very thin rasher of bacon, just touched with a soupçon of fresh mustard? I will come with you to the kitchen, and we will see what we can concoct together. A charming occupation.
I am helping my wife, Paravicini.
Your husband is afraid for you. Quite natural, under the circumstances. He doesn't fancy your being alone with me. It is my sadistic tendencies he fears, not my dishonorable ones. Alas, what an inconvenience the husband is. Arrivederla.
I'm sure Giles doesn't think that...
He is very wise. Take no chances. But how can I prove to you, or to him, or to our dogged sergeant, that I am not a homicidal maniac? So difficult to prove a negative. But I suppose instead I am really...
Don't.
What such a gay little tune. Don't you think? She cut off their tails with a carving knife. Snick, snick, snick. Delicious. Just what a child would adore. Cruel little things, children. Some of them never grow up.
Stop frightening my wife at once, Ferravicini.
I know it's silly of me, but I found her, and her face was all purple. I can't forget.
No. It is not easy to forget things. You are not the forgetting kind.
Go to the kitchen and take care of dinner, and everything's coming to pieces. Giles, will you please?
What did you say to the lady just now to upset her, sir?
Me, Sergeant? Just a little innocent fun.
There's nice fun, and then there's fun that's not so nice.
I wonder, what do you mean by that, Sergeant?
I've been doing a little wondering about you, sir.
Indeed.
I've been wondering about that car of yours, and how it just happened to overturn in a snowdrift so conveniently.
Inconveniently. Don't you mean, Sergeant?
That rather depends on the way you're looking at it. Just where were you bound for when you had this accident?
Oh, I was on my way to see a friend.
In this neighborhood?
Not very far from here.
And what was the name and address of this friend?
No, Sergeant. Does that matter now? I mean, it has nothing to do with this predicament, has it?
We police always like the fullest information. What did you say this friend's name was?
I didn't say.
No, you didn't say. Now that's very interesting.
But there could be so many reasons. In amor... discretion. Jealous husbands.
You're rather old to be running around with the ladies at your time of life, aren't you?
My dear Sergeant, I am not, perhaps, quite as old as I look.
That's exactly what I've been thinking, sir.
What?
You may not be as old as you try to look. There are a lot of people trying to look younger than they are. If somebody goes about trying to look older, well, it does make one ask oneself why.
Having asked so many questions of other people, you ask questions of yourself as well. Isn't that overdoing things?
I might get an answer from myself. I don't get many from you.
Well, well, try again. That is, if you have any more questions to ask.
One or two. Just where were you coming from when that night?
That is simple. From London.
What address in London?
I always stay at the Ritz Hotel.
Very nice, too, I'm sure.
What's your permanent address?
I dislike permanency.
What's your business or profession?
I play the markets.
Stockbroker?
No. You misunderstand me.
You're enjoying this little game, aren't you? Sure of yourself, too. But I shouldn't be too sure. You're mixed up in a murder case, and don't you forget it. Murder isn't just fun and games.
Not even this murder? Dear me, Sergeant Trotter, you're very serious. But I have always thought that policemen have no sense of humor.
That's personal.
Is the Inquisition over for the moment?
For the moment? Yes.
Good. Thank you very much. I shall go look for your skis in the drawing room. Just in case someone has hidden them in the grand piano.
Just a minute, please.
Were you speaking to me?
Yes. Would you mind sitting down?
What do you want?
You may have heard some of the questions I was asking Mr. Paravicini.
I heard them.
Well, I'd like to have a little information from you.
What do you want to know?
Full name, please.
Leslie Margaret Catherine Casewell.
Catherine?
I spelt with a K.
Quite so. Address?
Villa Mariposa, Pine d'Or, Mallorca.
That's in Italy?
It's an island. A Spanish island.
And what's your English address?
Care of Morgan's Bank, Leadenhall Street.
No other English address?
No.
How long have you been in England?
A week.
And you've been staying since your arrival?
At the Ledbury Hotel, Knightsbridge.
What brought you to Monkswell Manor, Miss Casewell?
I wanted somewhere quiet, in the country.
How long did you, or do you, propose to remain here?
Until I finished what I came here to do.
And what was that? What was that?
What?
I asked, what was it you came here to do?
I don't think I'll answer that question. It's none of your business anyway.
All the same, Miss Casewell.
No. No, I don't think I'll argue with you.
Do you mind telling me your age?
Not in the least. It's on my passport. I'm 24.
24?
You were thinking I looked older. That is quite true.
What are you doing here?
What am I doing here? That seems to worry you.
It does worry me. Were you born in Mallorca?
No. I left England when I was 12.
You say you left England when you were 12?
12, 13, thereabouts.
Was your name Casewell then?
It's my name now.
What was your name then? Come on, tell me.
What are you trying to prove?
I asked you a question. What was your name when you left England?
It's a long time ago. I've forgotten.
There are things one doesn't forget.
Possibly.
Unhappiness. Despair.
I dare say.
What's your real name?
I told you. Leslie Margaret Catherine Casewell.
Catherine? What are you doing here?
I... Oh, why did I come here?
I always thought the police weren't allowed to give the third degree.
I have merely been interrogating Miss Casewell.
You seem to have upset her. What has he done?
Oh, it's nothing. It's just all this murder. It's so horrible. It came over me suddenly. I think I'll go up to my room now.
It's impossible. I can't believe it.
What can't you believe? 6 impossible things before breakfast, like the Red Queen.
Oh yes, Mr. Wren. It's rather like that.
Dear me. You look as like you'd seen a ghost.
I've seen something I ought to have seen before. Blind as a bat I've been. But I think now we may be able to get somewhere.
The police have a clue.
Oh yes, Mr. Wren. At last the police have a clue. I want everybody in here again. Do you know where they are?
Giles and Molly are in the kitchen. I had been helping Major Metcalf to look for your skis. We've looked in the most entertaining places, but all to no avail. I don't know where Paravicini is.
I'll get him. You get the others. Paravicini? Paravicini! Stupid man.
Yes, Sergeant. What can I do for you? Little Bo Policeman has lost his skis and doesn't know where to find them. Leave them alone and they'll come home dragging a murderer behind them.
Must I come now? It's rather inconvenient.
There are more important things than meals, Mrs. Ralston. Mrs. Boyle, for instance, won't want another meal.
That's a very tactless way of putting things, Sergeant.
I'm sorry, but I want cooperation and I intend to get it. Mr. Ralston, would you mind going upstairs and asking Miss Casewell to come down again? Tell her it will only be for a few minutes.
Have your skis been found, Sergeant?
No, Mrs. Ralston, they haven't. But I may say that I have a very shrewd suspicion of who took them and of why they were taken. I won't say any more at the present moment.
Please don't. I always think that explanations should be kept to the very end. That exciting last chapter, you know.
This isn't a game, Paravicini.
Now there I think you are wrong. I think it is a game. To somebody.
You think the murderer is enjoying himself? Maybe. Maybe.
What's going on?
Sit down, Miss Caswell. Mrs. Ralston. You may remember that at the time Mrs. Boyle was killed, I took statements from you all. These statements related to your positions at the time the murder was committed. These statements are as follows. Mrs. Ralston in the kitchen preparing vegetables. Mr. Ralston in his bedroom. Mr. Wren, ditto. Miss Casewell writing letters in the library. Paravicini playing piano in the drawing room, and Major Metcalf in the cellar.
Correct.
These were the statements you made. I had no means of checking these statements. They may be true. They may not. To put it quite clearly, 5 of them are true, but 1 is false. Which one? 5 of you were speaking the truth. 1 of you was lying. I have a plan that may help me to discover the liar. And if I discover that 1 of you lied to me, then I know who the murderer is.
Not necessarily. Someone may have lied for some other reason.
I rather doubt that.
But what's the idea? You've just said that you have no means of checking these statements.
No, but supposing everyone was to go through these actions a second time.
Ah, that old chestnut. Reconstruction of the crime.
A foreign idea.
Not a reconstruction of the crime, Paravicini. A reconstruction of the movements of apparently innocent persons.
And what do you expect to learn from that?
You will forgive me if I don't make that clear just at the moment.
You want a repeat performance?
Yes, Mr. Ralston, I do.
Trap. Oh.
What do you mean it's a trap?
It's a trap, I know it is.
I only want people to do exactly what they did before.
But I don't see. I simply can't see what you can possibly hope to find by just making people do the things they did before. I think it's just nonsense.
Do you, Mr. Wren?
Well, you can count me out. I'm far too busy in the kitchen.
I can't count anybody out. One might almost think that you're all guilty by the looks of you. Why are you all so unwilling?
But of course, what you say goes, Sergeant. We'll all cooperate. Eh, Molly? Very well. Wren? Miss Casewell?
Yes.
Paravicini?
Yes, I consent.
Metcalf?
Yes.
Are we all to do exactly as we did before?
The same actions will be performed, yes.
Then I shall return to the piano in the drawing room, and once again, with one finger, pick out the signature tune of the murderer. Dum, dum, dum.
Not quite so fast, Paravicini. Mrs. Ralston, do you play the piano?
Yes, I do.
And you know the tune of Three Blind Mice?
Don't we all know it?
And then you could pick it out on the piano with one finger, just as Paravicini did? Good. Go into the drawing room, sit at the piano, and start to play when I give you the signal.
But, Sergeant, I understood that we were all to repeat our former roles.
The same actions will be performed, yes, but not necessarily by the same people. Thank you, Mrs. Ralston.
I don't see the point.
There is a point. It is a means of checking on the original statements, and maybe one statement in particular. Now then, will you all pay attention, please? I will assign each of you your new stations. Mr. Wren, would you kindly go into the kitchen? Just keep an eye on Mrs. Ralston's dinner for her. You're very fond of cooking, I believe. Paravicini, would you mind going up to Mr. Wren's room? By the back stairs is the most convenient way. Major Metcalf, would you mind going up to Mr. Ralston's room? Just examine the extension telephone there. Miss Casewell, would you mind going down to the cellars? Mr. Wren will show you the way. Unfortunately, I need someone to reproduce my own actions. I'm sorry to ask it of you, Mr. Ralston, but would you mind going out through that window and following the extension wire around near the front door? It's rather a chilly job, I know, but you're probably the toughest person here.
And what, may I ask, are you going to do?
I am enacting the part of Mrs. Boyle.
Taking a bit of a risk, don't you think?
You will all stay in your places and remain there until you hear me call you.
Parlor games.
No objection to my wearing a coat?
I should advise it, sir.
Take my torch. It's behind the curtain. Mrs. Ralston, count 20 and then begin to play. Mrs. Ralston? Mrs. Ralston?
What is it? You're looking very pleased with yourself. Have you gotten what you wanted?
I've got exactly what I wanted.
You know who the murderer is?
Yes,
I know. Which of them?
You ought to know, Mrs. Ralston.
I?
Yes. You've been extraordinarily foolish, you know. By holding out on me with information, you've risked a very good chance of being killed more than once.
I don't know what you mean.
Come now, Mrs. Ralston. We police aren't quite so dumb as you think. All along, I've realized that you had firsthand knowledge of the Longridge Farm affair. You knew Mrs. Boyle was the magistrate involved. In fact, you knew all about it. Why didn't you speak up and say so?
I don't understand. I wanted to forget.
Your maiden name was Waring?
Yes.
Miss Waring. You taught school. In the school where those children went.
Yes.
It's true, isn't it? The Jimmy, the child who died, managed to get a letter posted to you. That letter begged for help. Help from his kind, young teacher. You never answered that letter.
I couldn't. I never got it.
You just didn't bother.
That's not true. I went down with pneumonia that very day. The letter was set aside with others. It was weeks afterwards that I found it, among lots of other letters. But by then, that poor child was dead. Waiting for me. Hoping and gradually losing hope. It's haunted me ever since. If only I hadn't been sick, if only I could have done something, but it's monstrous that such things should happen.
Yes, it's monstrous.
I thought the police didn't carry revolvers.
Policemen don't. I'm not a policeman, Mrs. Ralston. You thought I was a policeman because I rang up from a call box and said I was speaking from police headquarters and that Sergeant Trotter was on his way. I cut the telephone wires before coming to the front door. You know who I am, Mrs. Ralston? I'm Georgie. I'm Jimmy's brother, Georgie. Better not scream, Mrs. Ralston, because if you do, I shall fire this revolver. I said I'd like to talk to you a little. I said I'd like to talk to you a little. Jimmy died. That nasty, cruel woman killed him. They put her in prison. Prison wasn't bad enough for her. I said I'd kill her one day when I grew up. I did, too. In the fog. It was great fun. I hope Jimmy knows. I said I'd kill them all one day when I grew up. Because grown-ups can do anything they like. I'm gonna kill you in a minute.
You better not. You'd never get safely away, you know.
Somebody's hidden my skis. I don't know where they are, but it doesn't really matter. I don't care if I get away or not. It's been such fun watching you all. Besides, I'm tired. Plus,
I got to pretend I was a policeman.
That revolver will make a lot of noise.
It will, rather. Much better to do it the way and take you by the neck. The last little mouse in the trap.
Georgie! Georgie, don't you know me? Don't you remember the farm, Georgie? And the animals? That fat old pig. And the day the bull chased us across the field? And the dogs?
Dogs?
Yes. Spot and Plain.
Kathy?
You do know me, don't you?
Kathy, it is you. What are you doing here?
I came to London to find you. But I didn't recognize you till you started twirling your hair. Yes, you always used to do that. Come with me, Georgie. You're coming with me.
Where are we going?
It's all right, Georgie. I'm taking you to a place where they look after you and see that you never harm anyone again. Step, Georgie.
Are you okay, Mrs. Ralston? Here, drink this. Ralston! Ralston!
Molly, are you all right?
Oh, Giles. Whoever would have thought it was Trotter. He's mad, quite mad.
Yes, but you.
I was mixed up in the whole thing. I taught at the school where those children went, and it wasn't my fault, but he thought I could have done something to help that boy.
You should have told me.
I wanted to forget.
Everything's okay now. He'll be unconscious soon with a sedative. His sister's looking after him. Poor fellow's as mad as a hatter, of course, but I've had my suspicions of him all along.
You didn't believe he was a policeman?
I knew he wasn't a policeman. You see, Mrs. Ralston, I'm a policeman.
You?
Yes. As soon as we got hold of that notebook with Monkswell Manor written in it, we saw it was vital to have someone on the spot. When put to him, Major Metcalf agreed to let me take his place. Couldn't understand it when Trotter showed up.
And Casewell's his sister.
Mm-hmm. Seems she recognized him just before this last business with the hair. Didn't know what to do about it, but luckily came to me just in time. Well, it's starting to thaw. Help should be here soon. Oh. By the way, Mrs. Ralston, I'll remove those skis. I hid them on top of the four-poster.
And I thought it was Parabaccini.
I expect they'll check that car of his rather carefully. Shouldn't be surprised if they found 1,000 or so Swiss watches in the spare wheel. Yes, that's his line of business. Nasty little bit of goods. Molly, I do believe you thought
Giles,
I was...
Giles, what were you doing in London?
Darling, I went to buy you an anniversary present. We've been married just a year today.
That's why I went to London, but I didn't want you to know.
No.
Mrs. Ralston, there's a terrible smell of burning coming from the kitchen.
Oh, my pie!